Well, Grandpa, there has to be a reason why Bob asked Lisa, because this is the first time he's invited her here or anywhere else, as a matter of fact, since they've been divorced.
Did you ask him why he invited her?
He said something about not wanting her to have Thanksgiving dinner alone. He didn't think it was right.
It was real nice of the boy.
And I thought about it, and I gave it a great deal of thought, Grandpa.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting. More details just arrived. These details, about the same as previously, President Kennedy shot today just as his motorcade left downtown Dallas. Mrs. Kennedy jumped up and grabbed Mr. Kennedy. She called, "Oh no," the motorcade sped on. United Press says that the wounds for President Kennedy perhaps could be fatal. Repeating, a bulletin from CBS News, President Kennedy has been shot by a would-be assassin in Dallas, Texas. Stay tuned to CBS News for further details.
It takes more than an instant to make a real cup of coffee. That's why.
And that's how it sounded 54 years ago. Actually, during the hour in which I am speaking right now, we're live at 1 o'clock Eastern Time here on November 22nd, 2017. So 54 years ago, and actually during this hour, and that was As the World Turns, being interrupted for this sickening news. And it's still very sickening to hear even now. So I almost feel as though we don't, but we could do a show like this one every year on November 22nd, because I think we're still very much living in the world created by that moment. You could almost say that the assassination of John F. Kennedy was kind of like the Big Bang, in the sense of the Big Bang just throwing forward the entire universe that we live in. The same goes in a certain way for this assassination. It threw forward the world that we continue to live in, a world in which people didn't trust the way they had trusted in the past, a world in which our notions of authority, particularly authority in the sense of who do you believe, who is a source of authoritative information, became upended and distorted. It's a world that continued to explode outward until 2016, when a conspiracy theorist, the kind of person who might have lived on the margins of thought in a different time, was elected president of the United States. I would argue, and I think our guests would argue, that these are not completely unconnected phenomena. So we are going to talk today about the assassination of John F. Kennedy, about its ramifications, but also because, in fact, this is such an ever-changing story. It's the other reason we could do it every year forever on this date, because it's a story whose fact pattern never really settles down. Joining us today for all of the show, actually, is Phil Sheenan. He is the author of A Cruel and Shocking Act, The Secret History of the Kennedy Assassination. It's a terrific book on this, winner of numerous awards, including the Francis Parkman Prize. He's been with us before. He's back now. Phil, thanks for coming back.
Colin, my pleasure.
So I don't know if you want to add to what I just said, but it does feel as though this isn't just a story that never goes away. In a way, it's a story that created some of the information environment that we'll probably live in for all of our lifetimes.
No, I agree with you with everything you just said. I mean, I think it is sort of the moment when America in many ways lost its innocence. Certainly, it is the moment that America began to feel it couldn't trust its government. It couldn't trust government officials to tell them the truth, even about something so basic as the murder of their president. And, you know, the cynicism about government truthfulness has just grown and grown as we've lived through Watergate and the Vietnam War and Iran-Contra and every sort of scandal, where we're at the point now where people believe that everything coming out of the government must be a lie.
I got an email today from a listener who had heard the promos for this show, and it's kind of on point for the kind of conversation we're probably going to have anyway. This person writes, I think his name is Richard. I think he writes, I'm not really a conspiracy theorist, but there's something I've wondered about ever since the Warren Commission decided to deep six their findings in 67. If Oswald acted totally alone in assassinating Kennedy, then why did they deny the citizens of the United States knowing the truth, or at least the facts that they were willing and able to present about this assassination of their president? And what, if anything, did we learn that was so controversial in those findings when they finally did release them a little while ago that might explain why the Warren Commission felt compelled to keep it from us all these years? Who or what were they protecting? What didn't they want us to know? It seems like we still don't know and likely never will. And there are a couple of things wrong with some of these assumptions in that email. But it is one of the questions that's asked by your book, right? That, you know, you have this idea of the Warren Commission, which originates just down the road from where I'm sitting at Yale Law School, with a phone call from its then dean saying you've got to, particularly in the wake of the ensuing events, you've got to create this sort of blue ribbon panel that will be able to dispositively put to rest these things. Johnson resists it for a while. Then he decides that, yes, he'll do it, but not quite the way he was told to do it. He really wants Earl Warren. Warren's a Republican. That helps. Warren is kind of beloved by pretty much everybody, or at least by lots of people on both sides of the aisle. That'll help. But, Phil, then they have this commission that, you know, in some ways is reflective of the uncertainty of the person who wrote me the email today, that rather than setting everything to rest, it does the opposite.
I agree with all of that. And, you know, what we now know from just the documentary record we've gotten from these declassified files over all these years is that the Warren Commission was never presented with all the evidence. Lots of important evidence, lots of important witnesses were hidden from them. And this leads to my conclusion that there was a conspiracy. There was a cover-up. There was a criminal cover-up that involved hiding just how much the CIA and the FBI and other agencies had known before the assassination about this man, Lee Harvey Oswald, and the threat he might pose. You know, my first book was about 9/11, and I draw the comparison that in both of these situations, the two great national tragedies of my lifetime, the government had a lot of information to suggest that something terrible was about to happen, but because of incompetence or laziness, they didn't act on that information, and the terrible thing happened, and then the agencies of government went out of their way in the hours and days and months that followed to hide evidence, to hide just how much they had known.
So your book begins with a the idea for your book begins with a guy who was staff to the Warren Commission, having read that previous book that you talked about, coming to you and saying, you know, we're going to start dying off pretty soon. You better start talking to us. Somebody better talk to us because there's a story that hasn't been told. Now, I would say one of the stories that's told in your book is that the Warren Commission suffered from the assumption that it had one sole purpose, to get to the bottom of things about this one particular event. But it didn't really. I mean, it seems to have suffered a lot from having all kinds of different purposes that often got in the way of that originating purpose. I mean, there's a whole section of your book, just for example, where there's a big discussion about whether they can even go to J. Edgar Hoover and ask him a series of questions. What if they do that? What'll he do if he? What'll they do? What will Hoover do if they ask him questions? I mean, you know, how will this compromise the status of the FBI? I mean, they have a lot of other things that they're worrying about besides what happened.
Absolutely. You know, Chief Justice Warren, who absolutely positively did not want to do this and was really sort of blackmailed into doing this by President Johnson. But his goal was to get this over with just as quickly as possible. Warren, in his own mind, settled very quickly on the idea that this was Lee Harvey Oswald, that there was no conspiracy, there was nothing much to investigate here, and there really was a rush to judgment by the Warren Commission, that because Chief Justice Warren was so determined to get this done in a hurry, a lot of loose ends resulted. And we also now know, too, that very powerful figures like J. Edgar Hoover at the FBI were going out of their way to hide information from the Warren Commission.
You know, one of the things that I've been puzzling over a little bit recently is the role of the media in all this. And I think the last time I talked to you, I just started reading Barbie Zellerzer's book, which is very much about that. But, you know, one of the things you pointed out at the beginning of the book is that, you know, different kinds of media were more powerful at that moment. And even before the Kennedy assassination, Drew Pearson, who was this kind of titanic syndicated newspaper columnist who had all kinds of amazing sources, was somebody who, A, knew a lot of stuff that was very germane to the presidency of John F. Kennedy and some of the things that we would later have trickle out into our understanding, and B, kind of almost had to be propitiated a little bit. I mean, one other really good reason for appointing Earl Warren to this pivotal position was he and Drew Pearson were really good friends, and Pearson might be a little bit better disposed towards the whole thing.
Yeah, and I will say, Drew Pearson's not somebody I knew much about going into my research on this book, but he is fascinating because he's kind of, he's half, this very respected newspaper columnist, and he's half the Drudge Report. And he's dealing with rumors and substantive stories at the same time, and it turns out that he's a very close friend of Earl Warren's, and he's going to support Earl Warren in the work of the Warren Commission, even though Drew Pearson, over the course of the Warren Commission investigation, keeps turning up scoops that really mess up the workings of the Warren Commission, that cause them to worry that information is being hidden from the commission.
And even before the assassination, he's talking to Bobby Baker, who's this very complicated figure. If we tried to explain that, we would be here all day. But he's about to go to press with some of the stuff about John F. Kennedy's sexual adventurousness anyway, or at least Baker is giving him some of that stuff.
Well, he's also giving information, Drew Pearson is also getting information that suggests that Lyndon Johnson is corrupt, mm-hmm. and he's about to publish that information just before the assassination occurs. And what seems to be a subtext of all this is that Lyndon Johnson wanted Earl Warren to lead this investigation because it was a way of muting Drew Pearson. Drew Pearson wasn't going to do anything to undermine Earl Warren's investigation, so that might keep some of the scandals of the Johnson administration under wraps during the course of those months.
Now, one of the things that was defining of this story was that television had come into its own. Zelizer makes the interesting point that Tom Wicker raced out to the airport in Dallas to be there to write his column, whereas Dan Rather raced away from the body towards the TV station because he understood that getting on the air live in Dallas, he was a Dallas reporter at the time, was really, really important. But one of the things that defined this, Phil, and I think made it ultimately really difficult ever to get everybody's confidence about what had really happened was the following thing, which unfolded right in front of everybody on live TV.
To Dallas, Texas, and Tom Pettit.
There is the president. There is Lee Oswald. He's been shot. He's been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot. There's the man with a gun. It's absolute panic. Absolute panic here in the basement of Dallas Police Headquarters. Detectives have their guns drawn. Oswald has been shot. There is no question about it. Oswald has been shot. Pandemonium has broken loose. Here in the basement of Dallas Police Headquarters.
So, you know, they called Vietnam the living room war. This was the living room tragedy. Everything about it happened on television, was covered on television. But Philip Sheehan, that particular moment was, I think, it was one of the reasons that Rostow suggested the idea of a Warren Commission, that it was going to be hard to get the toothpaste back in the tube when people saw this incredibly important suspect / defendant in, you know, the crime of their lifetimes just get shot by some random guy who happened to be there in the police station.
I think those 30 seconds of tape really are what explains why we've had to deal with 54 years of these wild conspiracy theories, because you can imagine millions of people are sitting in front of their television sets, and they see that 2 days after the president has been assassinated, also on national television, and they see that the assassin gets shot. Of course, there were conspiracy theories that very day that this man, Jack Ruby, this nightclub impresario from Dallas, had been dispatched to kill Oswald because Oswald was about to reveal the conspiracy behind Kennedy's death. And it's because of that whole incident we've been left with so many conspiracy theories about who might have dispatched Ruby to do this. And I think your larger point, this really was an important cultural moment. This is really the moment television came into its own. You know, apparently in the days after the assassination, Earl Warren sat in front of his television set. He was horrified by that fact, but that was the place to go. That was the place to watch this national tragedy unfold.
Now, let's fast forward ahead. This past summer and fall, because of some changes in the law, because of some changes in the way these records are regarded, some things were released. Apparently not everything was released. Did we learn anything new this year? Anything that we, anything important that we hadn't known?
Well, talk about cultural influence. This is also because of Oliver Stone's movie JFK in 1991. That movie created such a furor that Congress reacted by passing a law that forced the release of every document in the government's files that might somehow be related to the Kennedy assassination, and it put a 25-year deadline on release of everything, and that 25-year deadline came up last month. And we'd expected, hundreds of thousands of pages of classified documents to be released. But as you know, President Trump at the very last minute blocked that, and he's put another 6 months for review of these documents. And I believe we may never see all of them. But the documents that have been released in the last few weeks there's not much there that's particularly new, because a lot of those documents we'd seen in part in the past. But there were documents released over the summer that really were interesting and really offer some of the first suggestions about what may have been Lee Harvey Oswald's motives in killing Kennedy, which is a subject the Warren Commission really ducked.
We talked right around the time of the release earlier this year, and I asked you a different version of this question. But, really, at this point, the Soviet Union is gone. Fidel Castro is gone. Many of the people connected to this, most of the people who had a direct connection to all this are dead. Why is there still a file that can't be released?
Well, we can only theorize because we don't know what we don't know. But a lot of these documents, I suspect, are going to be institutionally very embarrassing for the CIA and the FBI because, again, they'll show just how much those agencies knew before the assassination about Lee Harvey Oswald. I think the record's very clear that if the CIA and FBI had just acted on the information in their own files in early November 1963, Kennedy would have survived his trip to Dallas. But we're also told that apparently some of these documents may refer to people who were CIA or FBI informants in the early 1960s who are still alive today and who might be in some danger if their identities were revealed now. And apparently some of these documents may also refer to relatively recent intelligence operations, maybe from the 1990s, that might still be in effect or still be in operation and might also be jeopardized.
All right, we're going to take a break. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about somebody who is still alive, and it is her birthday today, I believe. And we're going to tell you about a party that took place in Mexico City not long before the assassination of John F. Kennedy, where people were doing the twist. All right, we're back, and we're talking to Philip Sheenan. His book is A Cruel and Shocking Act, The Secret History of the Kennedy Assassination. In the final segment, we will backtrack to 1991 in the movie, which substantially, for better or worse, or accurately or otherwise, altered people's perceptions of this event, Oliver Stone's JFK, and talk about it as a movie as well as the fulcrum in our desire to know more about the Kennedy assassination. But I told you going into the break that we were going to tell you about a woman who's still alive. I believe she turns 80 today, and which is also very odd when you think about it. And her name is Sylvia Duran. She was at a party, we know this, in Mexico City. People were doing the twist. It has long been alleged that Lee Harvey Oswald was also at this party. This party was a few months before the assassination. Philip Sheenan, as you delved into this, I mean, you went down to Mexico City to find out more about this party, the notion of which had been kicking around on the fringes of Kennedy assassination talk for a while. And you did ultimately find out more than had been previously known about it. What did you learn?
Well, this is, to my mind, really the secret chapter of the Kennedy assassination saga, which involves this 6-day trip that Lee Harvey Oswald takes to Mexico just a few weeks, just a couple of months before the assassination, where we know from previously declassified files he's meeting with Cuban spies and Russian spies and other people who at the height of the Cold War might have wanted to see Kennedy dead. And there's actually one of these declassified files that suggests that Oswald was talking openly in Mexico City about his intention to kill Kennedy. This woman, Sylvia Duran, was a Mexican woman who worked on the staff of the Cuban embassy in Mexico City, and she's the person who deals face-to-face with Oswald as he's apparently trying to get a visa to go to Cuba. You know, he's a Marxist. He previously tried to defect to the Soviet Union. The story is that she apparently may have been introducing Oswald around town to Castro supporters, to other people who, again, might have wanted to see Kennedy dead at the height of the Cold War. You know, this is just a year after the Cuban Missile Crisis. And Sylvia Duran apparently takes Oswald to a party, a twist party, where there are people at this party who are talking openly about the need to see President Kennedy dead to save Castro's revolution. And this woman, Sylvia Duran, who's still alive, was never interviewed by the Warren Commission because Chief Justice Warren forbid it.
Right. And I mean, the desire to not know about this seems even more pervasive than that. You begin your book with the story of a man named Charles William Thomas, who seems to be, if not a rising star, a steadily upward moving meteor in the State Department, and then has his career stall out. He ultimately takes his own life, but not before memorializing, as James Comey would say, what he knows about this party. But it seems as though nobody wants him to do this, and nobody wants to forward these reports, and people who do, after maybe sitting on these reports, forward this information, they're not regarded happily either, are they?
Well, Thomas is really a kind of a tragic figure. He's this very ambitious, smart American diplomat who's stationed to Mexico City in the mid-1960s. And a couple of years after the Kennedy assassination, he stumbles onto information about this twist party. And he stumbles onto information suggesting that Oswald might have been meeting with people in Mexico City who wanted to see Kennedy dead. And he suspects that maybe there was a plot to kill Kennedy. It was hatched on Mexican soil. The Warren Commission had it all wrong. And he documents all this in memos that have been declassified in recent years. And he tries to get somebody to go back to Mexico City and investigate this to see whether or not there was some sort of conspiracy, that Oswald had associates in Mexico who were somehow involved. And he hits a brick wall. Nobody wants to investigate. And for very mysterious reasons, apparently involving a clerical error, some paperwork was misfiled from his personnel files, he's fired by the State Department. And a couple of years later, he takes his own life in Washington.
There's so much about this, but why this would be interesting would be at a number of different levels. But let's just start with the question of, it's just interesting if Lee Harvey Oswald was at a party where other people who were furious at Kennedy, and there was a lot of anger at Kennedy in a sense that Kennedy had it in for the Castro regime, was trying to overthrow the Castro regime. That wasn't any secret at that point. Might have also been involved in or be interested in extrajudicial attempts on Castro's life. So you've got Oswald standing at this party, hearing people essentially say, somebody ought to take this guy out, somebody ought to kill this guy. I mean, that all by itself is interesting, because even if you think that Oswald acted alone, it might mean that he wasn't ideologically alone.
Absolutely. You know, and the people at this party are Cuban diplomats and spies. You know, these are people who probably had very good reason to fear that the Kennedy administration was trying to end their revolution in Cuba. And, of course, we now know that that's absolutely true and that President Kennedy was trying to assassinate Fidel Castro. You know, those people may have feared that unless Kennedy's administration was ended, Castro would not survive. And if Oswald is in Mexico talking openly about killing Kennedy, and he's in at a party where other people are encouraging that idea, that's something you would think the Warren Commission and other investigators would want to get to the bottom of. But, of course, we now know that all of this, or at least most of this information, was denied to the Warren Commission.
Right. And Well, there's so much more about this, but one of the things that also makes there's sort of a fog of espionage that sits over this and so many other situations like this. Mexico City at this point is this incredible kind of den of skullduggery. I mean, all the Cold War players have their big Latin American operations going on there, and nobody really knows exactly who anybody is. So this Sylvia Duran, who may have also had a romantic or sexual relationship with Oswald during his visit there, nobody's exactly clear who she's working for. She might be working for any number of players. And she, unless I'm getting this all wrong, which is very possible, she probably has her doubts about Oswald. There's things about Oswald that don't add up to us and probably didn't add up very well at the time. He's asking to go to Cuba on the pretext that he's sort of a fidelista. You know, on the other hand, he might be CIA, right? He might be somebody going there with much more seditious, from Cuba's point of view, plans, right?
Oh, absolutely. You know, and I think it is probably likely that when the Cubans and the Soviets saw how sort of delusional, what a delusional misfit Oswald was, they wanted to have nothing to do with him, or they thought he was some sort of CIA plant, that he was some sort of agent provocateur who'd been sent by the CIA to make trouble in Mexico City. But one thing I should make clear is that we also know from all these declassified records that as Oswald is moving around Mexico City seeing these people, he is under surveillance by the CIA. They're watching him. They're listening to his telephone calls. They know about these meetings. There are records to suggest the CIA had surveillance photographs of Oswald. But all of this information would disappear after the assassination, I believe, because the CIA wanted to hide just how much they had known about Oswald, especially in Mexico City.
Right. So, I mean, that's, in a weird way, I've said this for pretty much all of my adult journalistic life. Whenever we start talking about any kind of conspiracy, I almost always say, assume government incompetence first, because they're not really, really all that good at carrying out these kind of airtight plots to do things, whereas a lot of things happen that are initially mistakes, and then they don't want anyone to know about it. And so here you've got the CIA knowing stuff that, retrospectively, is incredibly, you know, desperately material to this catastrophe. And the FBI essentially has the same problem, right up to and including a visit by Oswald to the FBI. Was it, did he show up the New Orleans office or the Dallas office?
It was the Dallas office. And I opened my book with that anecdote, which is that, you know, 2 days after Kennedy's assassination, the day that Oswald was killed by Jack Ruby, an FBI agent in Dallas takes a note. This is a handwritten note that Oswald had left at the Dallas field office of the FBI just a couple of weeks before, and he tears it up and he flushes it down a toilet because the FBI in Dallas is petrified that this will show just how much they had known about the threat that Oswald posed. And there are people who will tell you that that note contains some sort of threat of violence.
You know, all of this, I mean, the other part of this, and I think, you know, that kind of cover-up probably is a cover-up of incompetence. And we could argue it back and forth that the FBI and the CIA were looking at so many different people in so many different ways here in the thick of the Cold War that they might not necessarily have seen this guy and thought, oh, well, we ought to make him priority number one or something close to it. But there's another part to this, and I think it underlies some of the modern thinking about this event, which is that if, in fact, Oswald, who was already radicalized in a bunch of different ways, was further radicalized and radicalized to the specifics of this act, to killing Kennedy, by a lot of Castro-sympathizing Cubans in Mexico City who really not unreasonably saw Kennedy as hell-bent on the destruction of the Castro regime and maybe the assassination of Castro himself. It sort of changes one of the ways we look at John F. Kennedy. We look at him in all kinds of different ways. And, you know, for a lot of us, he is this, you know, this forward-looking president who talked about frontiers, you know, who who might have, if you believe Oliver Stone and other people, you know, not committed us to the mess we got into in Vietnam. But there's another way in which he and his brother are these really kind of bare-knuckled, swashbuckling cold warriors, particularly vis-a-vis Cuba. That there's almost no mistaking the fact that they really were, you know, in a very aggressive and adventuring way, poking a stick into the lair of Fidel Castro.
Absolutely. You know, people forget, you know, or they tend to forget in this sort of golden legacy, in creating this golden legacy for Kennedy, that, you know, he's the guy who got us into Vietnam. That's where the Vietnam War begins, in the Kennedy administration. And, of course, one of the first things that happens when after Kennedy comes to office is this disaster at the Bay of Pigs, where the CIA is trying to overthrow Castro. And we now know, too, that Kennedy repeatedly tried to assassinate Castro. And, you know, one of the sort of tragic conclusions about this is that it's quite possible that, in a sense, this what happened to Kennedy was blowback for his efforts to kill Castro. And there were interesting documents over the summer that show this theory was pursued at the CIA, that Oswald in New Orleans, which is where he was living at the time, sees a newspaper article in September 1963 in which Castro says that he knows that Kennedy is trying to kill him, that he knows that Kennedy is trying to assassinate him, and that Oswald, who's a supporter of Castro, a Marxist, becomes so outraged on Castro's behalf at the suggestion that there are assassination plots that he sets out to kill Kennedy, that he's going to kill Kennedy before Kennedy can kill Castro, which suggests that it's the foreign policy of the Kennedy administration, this Cold Warrior mentality of Kennedy and his brother Bobby, that leads to the assassination of John Kennedy.
So there are all kinds of interesting kind of secondary players, although not very secondary players, who have their reputations on the line with some of these stories. And we won't have time to do all of them. And I do recommend Philip Sheehan's book, by the way, A Cruel and Shocking Act, The Secret History of the Kennedy Assassination. It's about 600 pages, so you can read it in almost exactly the amount of time it takes you to watch Oliver Stone's JFK, which I'm convinced is 18 hours long, even though they tell you it's only three. You know, one of them is somebody that I've been thinking about a lot in a different context recently, and that's James Jesus Angleton, the so-called, you know, great intelligence spook of the Cold War. I've been thinking of him a lot because I hadn't understood until recently how unbelievably close he was to Kim Philby without having any idea what Kim Philby was up to. Here's this guy who's this tremendous mastermind, and he's like getting drunk all the time with Kim Philby with no clue who he's dealing with whatsoever. So Angleton is also kind of all over this Warren Commission Kennedy assassination story. What overall stamp does he leave on it?
Oh, I will say that in the history of the CIA, there may have been nobody who did such damage to that institution apart from James Angleton. You know, he was the chief spy hunter within the CIA. He was head of counterintelligence. And early on in his time at the CIA, he befriends this British MI6 agent who's working in Washington, who's named Kim Philby. And it turns out that Kim Philby is a Russian spy. And the disclosure that Philby is a Russian spy really sends Angleton into a spiral. He becomes this delusional, paranoid nut in many ways, but he remains at the CIA. And it's now clear from the record that he is the guy who controls the flow of information from the CIA to the Warren Commission. And it's also clear that he hid a lot of information from the Warren Commission. Information, again, that would have shown just how much the CIA had known about Oswald, the fact that they had him under surveillance before the assassination, information that would have been very damaging to the CIA if it had become public at the time.
Overarchingly, there's a sense that one takes away from your book that obviously the Warren Commission themselves were imperfect. All the actual commissioners are now dead. Jerry Ford was the last one of them to die. You're talking a lot to the staff, who obviously would have some interest in telling the best possible story in most cases about the Warren Commission. But everything that you're saying even now suggests to me that you see the failing more as the other arms, the investigative arms of government, failing to share everything that it knew with the Warren Commission. You can't really measure the 888-page work or whatever it was, work of the Warren Commission, without saying, well, they thought they were being told everything material and they just weren't, not by a long shot.
Well, no, I'm very critical of the Warren Commission. You know, I think they did rush the investigation. There were a lot of witnesses never interviewed. This woman in Mexico City, Sylvia Duran, mm-hmm. that the staff felt was maybe the most vital witness they could talk to. Earl Warren, in maybe his most baffling decision, decides that she won't be interviewed. And she's still alive today. She may still have a lot to tell. And Warren makes other terrible decisions. He doesn't allow the staff to see the autopsy photos or the x-rays of the president, which leads to the presentation of the medical evidence in the report to be so bungled that we still deal with lots of conspiracy theories about the medical evidence. I'm very critical. I'm much less critical of the staff of the Warren Commission, the people who did the actual detective work. These are mostly hotshot young lawyers then in their 20s or their 30s, who I think were working their heart out to try to find the truth and were open to the idea of a conspiracy. And they're the guys who are principal sources for my book. And I think they did their best to do a good job, though I think most of them are pretty horrified to discover how much information was withheld from them in 1964.
Not only horrified, but at times outraged. One of your sources, David Slauson, in particular, has, and I think this is part of it that I hadn't thought very much about, has some pretty hard things to say about Bobby Kennedy.
Oh, Bobby Kennedy, I think, his participation in this whole drama is very troubling because it's very clear he went out of his way to withhold information from the Warren Commission and really to lie on the public record. He kept saying on the public record that he supported the Warren Commission findings, he believed Lee Harvey Oswald had acted alone, there was no conspiracy, when in fact behind the scenes he's telling his friends and advisors just the opposite. He's saying that he thinks there might well have been a conspiracy involving the mafia, involving Cuba, but he doesn't want the Warren Commission to pursue those theories because, again, it might point to just how much skullduggery there had been in the Kennedy administration, including the plots to kill Castro.
All right, we've got to take a break. We're going to go back and spend our final segment talking about the movie that changed so many people's minds. It's going to take until about midnight to do this, to discuss this movie. So you might want to just use the bathroom right now. And then at midnight, you'll be free to go. But we'll be talking about Oliver Stone's JFK right after this.
Say definitively from Oliver Stone's movie that this assassination is one more thing with strong connections to Kevin Bacon. Today's show was produced by Jonathan McPants and me, Kyone Wolf. The part of Amanda Fish was played by Donald Sutherland. The part of our interns, Evan Sobel and Ashley Taylor, was played by Kiefer Sutherland. Bill Curry's dialect coach was Kevin Costner. Tomorrow and Friday, enjoy some special holiday programming, and we'll be back on Monday with The Scramble. And now, back to Colin.
The third shot, frame 232, hits Kennedy in the back, pulling him downward and forward. Conley, you will notice, shows no signs at all of being hit. He is visibly holding his Stetson, which is impossible if his wrist has been shattered. Conley is turning here now, frame 238, the fourth shot. It misses Kennedy and takes Conley in the back. This is the shot that proves there were two rifles. Conley yells out, "My God, they're going to kill us all." Somewhere around this time now, another shot that misses the car completely strikes James Tay down by the underpass. The car breaks. The sixth and fatal shot, frame 313, takes Kennedy in the head from the front. This is the key shot. The president going back and to his left. Shot from the front and right. Totally inconsistent with the shot from the depository. Again. Back and to the left. Back and to the left. Back and to the left.
That, of course, is from the climactic hour 7 of JFK, where you hear Kevin Costner as New Orleans DA Jim Garrison. as Oliver Stone attempted to set the record straight by showing us Jim Garrison giving a speech, which he, in fact, never gave. But I have a somewhat toxic attitude towards this movie. I think I was described on Twitter as butthurt about it. That's probably been coming through here. We're talking to Philip Sheenan. His book is A Cruel and Shocking Act, The Secret History of the Kennedy Assassination. Joining us now is Sean O'Neill, editor of the AV Club. Last month he wrote Oliver Stone's JFK Made Me a Creepy Kid and Now a Disappointed Adult. He's with us now. Actually, before we go to Sean, since we just played that clip, Phil Sheenan, if there's one thing that the movie JFK does a really good job of convincing almost anybody who watches it, it is of the invalidity of the single bullet theory. The way that Garrison, who did not give a speech about the ballistics at the end of the trial, the way that Garrison in the movie goes through that ballistic evidence and kind of mocks it makes you sit there wondering how any fool could have ever believed it. But in fact, that's not your position, right?
Well, you know, I, as I say about that film, you know, Oliver Stone, I think, is a very, very fine filmmaker. He's a pretty lousy historian, though. And I will say I have to answer for those 5 minutes from the courtroom scene with Kevin Costner almost everywhere I go, because it really misrepresents a lot of the scientific evidence. It certainly misrepresents this thing called the single bullet theory. You know, if you leave that, you leave the theater seeing the film believing that it's not possible that one bullet went through President Kennedy and into the body of Governor Connally, the Texas governor who's in the car, as the Warren Commission staff found, when in fact it looks like that probably is what happened. But again, that film created so much of a furor in 1991 that I've got to be grateful to it, because the furor is what's resulting in the release of these hundreds of thousands of pages of documents.
Absolutely. It did change the whole calculus here. So, Sean O'Neill, first of all, how old were you when you first watched JFK?
I was 13 years old the first time, and I was there opening night. I begged my mother to take me on opening night, so I was there when the lights went down, and I actually saw it in Dallas. So it felt very much like a big moment for me. I, as I said in my piece, which you may have read, I considered it my Harry Potter in some ways.
Right. So, but if you're the kind of kid who's at 13 and in 1991 begging his mother to take him to the Oliver Stone JFK movie, that would suggest that you were already on a certain kind of path as opposed to having been set upon one by Oliver Stone in his movie.
That's true. I mean, I had grown up, you know, 30 minutes away from Dallas. I took a weird sort of civic pride in being the city that almost killed Kennedy, being next door to it anyways. And I wrote a paper in sixth grade that was about the Warren Commission report. Totally blew the doors off it in my two-page report that I wrote when I was 11, and spent the next couple of years being very much obsessed with the JFK assassination. So by the time the movie came out, I was very ready to see these. What I regret saying now were almost characters in my mind, you know, the babushka lady, the umbrella man, these kinds of figures that I just read about, but I've seen them sort of brought to life on the big screen.
You know, I think one of the things that this movie did, in addition to what Philip Sheenan said, was upended our conventional thoughts about authority. Not that they hadn't been upended in lots of other ways already by Vietnam and Watergate and the initial wave of distrust of the Warren Commission's findings. But I mean, this movie, kind of the way Dan Brown's, the movie version of The Da Vinci Code, you know, a lot of people who saw that and said, really? You mean the stuff in the Bible might not be true? There might be like this whole counter-narrative or non-canonical story about Jesus and Mary Magdalene and stuff like that. You know, that for a lot of people, seeing this movie, Sean, was like sort of seeing this whole new set of information or a whole new set of eyes to put on information. You can't trust people you should be able to trust.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I believe it's a 14-page monologue that Donald Sutherland unspools as Mr. X there when he's talking to Kevin Costner on the bench. And in that sequence, I think, is buried a lot of the seeds of what became sort of the paranoid X-Files sort of hunt for the truth that kind of defined the 90s, and seeing that as a 13-year-old, especially when you're just getting this first taste of maybe institutions don't have all the answers, maybe grown-ups are not to be trusted, it really has a powerful impact on you. And, you know, my mother was a forward newspaper reporter, and one of her good friends was Jim Mars, the man who wrote Crossfire, the book that that formed a lot of the basis of Oliver Stone's screenplay for JFK. And, I got my book signed by him, and the first thing he wrote on the author page was, you know, always question authority, which is the coolest thing you could ever hear as a 13-year-old.
Right, so Phil Sheenan, since he mentions the Donald Sutherland thing, so I rewatched JFK last night, much to my dissatisfaction. And the Donald Sutherland thing, where so Jim Garrison, Kevin Costner, goes to Washington, D.C. and has this cherry blossom festooned, surreptitious meeting with this unknown Colonel X, who tells him all kinds of stuff really fast. I have no trouble believing it's 14 pages. This happened, that happened, this happened. I was in New Zealand. The newspapers already knew about it before it even happened. How could that be? If I were Jim Garrison, I would go, slow down, start over. I didn't get all that stuff. But Phil Sheenan, how much of that stuff has any real connection to the record as we understand it?
Well, it certainly had a real connection to the, you know, by this point, there was a library of conspiracy theory books out there. And essentially what Stone did is he took every one of those theories and somehow introduced them to the conspiracy that the film portrays. And I'll tell you, at the end of the film, you can't really tell what that conspiracy is. It seems to be some sort of government-wide conspiracy involving the CIA, involving the Pentagon, to kill Kennedy, to make sure that the Vietnam War continued. But I will say that the other problem with that film was the presentation of it. It was presented by the major Hollywood studio as this is the truth, and there were books that were issued by the studio along with it to say this is really what the truth is. And I can see where at this point in 1991, you know, after Watergate, after Iran-Contra, after everything that had made the public so cynical about being told the truth by the government, they were ready to embrace every possible conspiracy theory about the Kennedy assassination, which is what this Hollywood movie studio offered them.
So, Sean, today we have a conspiracy theorist in the White House, and I think there are some of us who would say, well, you could kind of draw a not unbroken line from one of these things to the other, and certainly maybe from Stone's movie to the notion that somebody with some pretty wacky ideas about the birthplace of Barack Obama could get elected president himself. What's your take on that?
Well, I mean, I am completely disappointed to find myself, you know, 22 years later, basically I took a very anti-authoritarian stance as a teenager, and somehow I ended up on the side of actual authoritarians, and it's all because of that sort of seed of mistrust that that was sort of planted by the popularization of JFK and this belief that the government is lying to you, the idea of a deep state existing. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that fuels people like Roger Stone, who are, you know, sowing chaos purposefully amongst people, making sure people are confused enough that they don't know exactly who is the establishment, who to trust. And that sort of, chaos that they've created, someone like Donald Trump can come forward and say, well, I am the answer. I am the anti-establishment person. So, yes, it is in some ways like a horseshoe shape. You know, you have this far left paranoid conspiracy that almost intersects with the far-right paranoid conspiracy, and may definitely benefit from it.
Well, I want to say thank you to Philip Sheenan and Sean O'Neill, both of whom I trust explicitly and implicitly. Phil Sheenan, the author of, as I keep saying, A Cruel and Shocking Act, The Secret History of the Kennedy Assassination. Sean O'Neill is the editor of the AV Club. He recently wrote about the impact of Oliver Stone's movie on his consciousness. And I want to end by reading one of the better things that I think has been written about this. It's actually from a novel. It's from Don DeLillo's Libra. He's talking about a guy named Nicholas Branch, a CIA guy who's trying to figure out this thing. He writes, if we are on the outside, we assume a conspiracy is the perfect working of a scheme. Silent, nameless men with unadorned hearts. A conspiracy is everything that ordinary life is not. It's the inside game, cold, sure, undistracted, forever closed off to us. We are the flawed ones, the innocents, trying to make some rough sense of the daily jostle. Conspirators have a logic and a daring beyond our reach. All conspiracies are the same story of men who find coherence in some criminal act, but maybe not. His character, Nicholas Branch, thinks he knows better. He has learned enough about the days and months preceding November 22nd, and enough about the 22nd itself to reach a determination that the conspiracy against the president was a rambling affair that succeeded in the short term due mainly to chance. Deft men and fools, ambivalence and fixed will, and what the weather was like.
Oh, the day John Kennedy.